Okay, so Lakshmi Ram, shall I begin now?
Yes, Shalini, by all means.
Okay. So good day, everyone, and a very warm welcome to today's webinar presented by Culture Legends. On behalf of the entire Culture Legends family, I, Shalini Sio, would like to thank you all for joining us today with an intriguing topic, Culture as the Fifth C of Hardiness, the Indian Perspective. So before we begin, I would like to give you all a short briefing of Culture Legends. So Culture Legends is an agile HR transformation company founded with an intent to drive transformation in organizations, individuals, and management students. We offer consulting and coaching services as well as organized agile HR training. And now, as we are pleased and super excited ahead, let me welcome the speaker of the session today, Dr. Pallavi Munt, who is an assistant professor at DAV School of Business Management, Bhubaneswar. She is also a published author of the book called Culture and Resilience at Work, a study of stress and hardiness among Indian corporate professionals. She has also worked with some of the top names as an HR professional before she took up academics as a profession. And for those of you who might not be knowing, well, Pallavi ma'am is my professor in my college. And let me tell you that she has been the most amazing teacher and a mentor to me in the past 1 year. And I am extremely humbled and grateful to her for accepting my proposal and agreeing to do this webinar today. So thank you so much, ma'am. Now, without any further ado, let us all now welcome to our speaker of the day, Dr. Pallavi Munt.
Okay, Shalini, the pleasure is all mine, as I said. So you always make me proud. And my pleasure to accept your invitation. I'm very happy and excited for this webinar today. And I'm like very happy to see Lakshmi ma'am also here. So let me start
Thank
off
you,
with, yeah, Shalini.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It is an immense pleasure to have you with.
Okay. Good evening to one and all present over here. And because I'll be talking about culture, I would like to start off my session with Namaste. And Namaste means I'm bowing down to the divine self of you. And the divine self is the same. Like that is the same within you and me. And I'm bowing down to you. I'm saying greetings of the moment in terms of Hindu culture. So let me just share my screen now. Shalini, tell me if it's not visible, okay?
Yes, sure.
Hope I'm clearly audible.
Yes, ma'am, you are. And the screen is visible as well.
Okay. So this is the topic of our session today. So culture as the fifth C of hardiness, the Indian perspective. Now, why the Indian perspective? Because culture is a common factor that we see across different countries and different parts of the world. But what is so special about Indian culture and how it makes a person hardy, how it develops the hardiness in a person or an individual, that is what is my research all about. And that is what my book also says, which Shalini has already introduced. So let me start off with this session, with this topic. Points to be covered today. I will first take you through the introduction of stress resilient hardy personality, which I hope many of you will not be aware of. Then I will proceed towards the four C's of hardiness. Like hardiness has a few components, and the prior researchers have also the prior researches that have been done on hardiness have already published a lot of components of hardiness, and we have come across almost four C's of hardiness, and I have included the fifth C of hardiness as culture. And I will also tell you a brief about how inculcating stress resilient hardy personality in the workforce will help organizations become more agile and have a sustainable and more productive organizational culture. So now this is what is a situation which we all come across, like any point of our time, any point of of our life, or maybe few of you would be undergoing this situation right now, where we feel that we are going to get blown up and we don't have any control over the situation. We are dejected, we feel frustrated, we feel depressed, we feel broken down. So what is this situation called as? Now, this is a situation where we recognize stress and we also try to identify the impact of harmful effects of stress. Now, what is stress? It is a feeling of physical or emotional tension and a feeling of being unable to cope with anxiety and demands of a particular situation. So as we all know, like when we undergo stress, we often feel that we do not find any solution to our problems. And this stress can make or come into a lot of forms, like it can spoil your physical and psychological well-being also. So when you have some diseases, physical diseases like acidity, hypertension, cardiovascular diseases, or any other disease, you know that it is the stress that is acting upon you. And when you get into depression or anger tantrums or anything that hurts your emotions or the emotional well-being, then you also know that that is the stress which is the underlying cause, and it is trying to trigger your negative emotions more often. So is stress always negative? Now, this is a question that we always feel and we always think, like common people would think that stress is always negative and it has always a harmful effect on people. No, it is not so. Okay. So stress is something which can be positive as well as negative. Now, when it is positive, when it propels you towards better performance or motivates you towards accomplishing a task, or it helps you to undergo something very challenging, like how I have been preparing myself since a long time about this webinar. So a little bit of stress or optimum level of stress is okay. That is positive. That is good for you, because that is good for your health. That is good for your emotional well-being. And that ultimately results in satisfaction of the task accomplished. So that is good for you. But when the stress is something that you are, like when there is a situation when you are getting into a situation where it is intolerable and you're unable to cope up with it, and the tension is increasing day by day, you get into distress. And distress is something which is negative. It is negative for your physiological as well as psychological well-being. So when distress comes in, your illnesses also come in. And considerable research also indicate that stressful life events and stresses contribute to the development of physical and psychological illnesses. So when I was studying on this, the stress and hardiness and the relationship of hardiness acting as a buffer for stress, I came across a lot of studies, prior studies since the 1950s, 60s and 70s, which have shown how stress has been very harmful to the health of the individual or well-being of the individual. So there has been an established link over the years between stress and health. However, it is also true that certain individuals respond differently to stress, and many remain healthy even under high stressful situations. Now, you might have observed many of your colleagues or your friends, your peer group, a few of them would be very calm, composed and cool enough even under high stressful situations, and they can overcome the stress very easily. So these are the people who are different from those who are very stress prone. So what is the stress, what is the underlying cause which makes them resilient to stress? Now that is hardiness. So hardiness is a stress resilient personality. It is a personality disposition of an individual which helps him to overcome very high stressful situations. So you will identify hardiness in a person only when that person is undergoing a very high and stressful situation. You will not find this hardiness identified in an individual when he is in a low stress condition, because low stress conditions most often is people will be able to cope with it. But if when you are in a high stressful situation, it will be very difficult for a person to overcome it. And this concept of hardiness was first developed by Susan C. Kobasa in the year 1979. And she defines this as a personality disposition which acts as a buffer against stressful life situation. Now, how it acts as a buffer? It helps you in better performance. It helps you in having job satisfaction. It also helps you in reducing your diseases related to heart, your stomach, your It also helps you in enhancing the emotional well-being. So many prior researchers have established this positive link, and they have also identified hardiness as a moderator in all these aspects that I said. So hardy individuals have a different personality than the non-hardy individuals who can withstand high level of stress and do not become ill under stressful circumstances also. So let us first understand what is hardiness and the three C's of hardiness. First is challenge, second is control, and third is commitment. Now coming to this commitment part. So commitment means being committed or being involved in your work, in your relationship, being committed or you being committed to anything and everything in your life. So it is like you're having a purpose in life, you have a target to achieve, and you're constantly working on it. Now, how do you achieve this commitment? You have to set different goals. Like if you have a long-term goal in hand, then you have to break down that final goal into short-term goals and try to achieve those short-term goals one by one. And you have to be very perseverant and consistent in achieving those short-term goals. So as and when you try to achieve those short-term goals, overall, you will be achieving the long-term goal also. And this commitment is not so easy. Now you will find many people around you, your peer group or your professionals, your colleagues, which like they will not be committed enough because they will be either at some or the level of this hierarchy. So the people who are non-committal, they will be like, I will not do it. And I will influence others also not to do it. So they are not people who are very committed to their work, committed to relationships, or they have any, like they do not have any purpose in hand. But if you see, go up the ladder of this commitment hierarchy, then you will see few other people who are like complainant. And they will always say, why should I do it if nobody says me to do so? So unless somebody says me, I will do that or else I will not do. So they will be like, they will come into that category of complainant. Compliance, I have to do it and I can do it when I'm told. So the third level or third category of this commitment will be the people who will say that I can do it because I'm told to do so. So when they are told to do so, only then they will do something. But all these three categories are not called commitment in hardiness. When do you say that a person is committed in hardiness or a person is having a hardy personality and is committed to his or her work and relationship is when he or she will say, I will do it and I will lead others also to do it. So it is his own self-motivation or self-drive which propels him towards accomplishing the task or being more committed to his work. Now, who is controlling you? The second C of hardiness. So we often come across life situations where we feel like many things are not in our control and few of the things which are in our control. So what do you feel when you do not score well, when you are rejected in a job interview, or when you are not having a good, like having a good time at your workplace and you think all the things going around are wrong or everything is going negative around you. So how do you feel? Like you feel that you don't have any control over these events, okay? And you feel that the strings are being pulled by someone else. It is not you who has a control over the events, but there is someone else who is trying to pull up the strings, okay? So when you are rejected or when you often face failure in life, you feel that it is fate or it is luck that is controlling me. And that is the reason why I failed. You do not try to introspect on yourself and see that what is the reason why I failed. So when we say that we do not have any control over the events happening around us, we are a person who has an external locus of control. So our control is situated somewhere external, like somewhere outside our body. But when we say that our internal locus of control, when we say that we have internal locus of control or we have a control over the events that are happening around us, then we say that it is the internal locus of control. So hardiness talks about the internal locus of control. It doesn't say that if anything bad happens, it's not my fault, it's the fault of fate. But a hardy personality will say that it is me who is responsible for this failure. It is me who is responsible for this rejection. And it is me who has to ponder open and find out what is the problem underlying within me and how should I rectify it and overcome it and become a successful person. Coming to the third C, So we always have two ways in life, or two directions that we have to go for. So one will be a zone which will be very comfortable and without any hurdle or difficulties. And another will be something like very challenging enough. And we often have a tendency of choosing the path which is more comfortable, because we do not want to go through a path which is having a lot of hurdles and difficulties. We want an easy life all the time. But in reality, life is not so. And many of you will agree with this. So life is very harsh most of the times. And in reality, life always gives you situations where you have to act upon those challenges. Always try to convert those challenges into opportunities. Only then you will become a hardy personality. So always try to choose the path that is more challenging. Because when you try to choose the path that is more hardier, or more harder or more challenging, you try to explore your own hidden potentialities. You try to become stronger and stronger. So a hardy personality is one who tries to choose the path which is more challenging and not comforting, so that he explores his own hidden potentialities and he gets through life's challenges. He overcomes the challenges into opportunities and becomes stronger and stronger. So when life gives you a lot of challenges, always try to explore those challenges or convert those challenges into opportunities. So when you try to convert these into opportunities, you try to dig deep within yourself and you try to find out what are the hidden potentialities which were unexplored yet till now. So you try to explore the unexplored when you become a challenging person, and you try to overcome all the obstacles in life. Now coming to the fourth C, connection. So this is something that was added upon to the three C's of Kobasa later on, much later, like many, many years after Kobasa started off with the three C's of hardiness. And this was done when S.R. Mahdi, Salvatore Mahdi, came up with this concept because of his connection with his clients. He was a psychologist, he was a therapist, clinical psychologist, certified clinical psychologist, and he has his Hardiness Institute also in Chicago. But unfortunately, we lost him last year, and I was in touch with him through LinkedIn. So he developed this fourth C that is called as connection. Now, what does this connection mean? Connection is the link between you and the client. Or the connection is the link or bonding or attachment you have with others around you. So this might be anyone, your family member, your friend, your partner, your life partner, your professional help also. So when we see that we do not seek this connection or social support, which he also explains connection as social support. He says in a community, we get connection through social support, and we get the support from the people living in the society. And who are these people? Your family, your friends, your partners, and any professional help. So when you are in a situation and you're not getting support or psychological support from your family, friends, and partner, you take the help or you seek the help of professional people or professional therapists. So he says this is something that has developed out of therapies, a lot of sessions in therapies. And only when you have that comforting zone or you feel like you can confide upon that person, you develop this connection more often. Now, how do we see this in corporate professionals? So when we have a system like career counselors, or we have someone, the manager or supervisor, acting as your counselor. So why do we have this concept, or why do we have this function there in any organization? Because the supervisor will be someone who will be mentoring you throughout your tenure in that organization. And the employee will be able to confide in himself or herself and share all his problems, whatever he's facing at workplace. And he'll try to rectify his mistakes, whatever is happening. And he talks it out very clearly with his supervisor. This happened with me also when I was working as a professional in Accenture. So we had our direct manager as our supervisor. So we used to have a one-on-one session with him, maybe a weekly or maybe monthly, in terms of requirement, whatever is the requirement. If it is an emergency and he sees that we are not meeting the targets, then we used to have weekly meetings with him. And if it was not that urgent, we used to meet at least a month, once in a month. So during that time, I used to discuss all my problems with him. I was a fresher at that time. So whatever issues I had to discuss with him. So there was a connection here. So if you try to be more connected with your manager, connected with your supervisor, then you can develop this fourth C, that is connection in yourself also as a professional. Am I audible, Shalini? Clearly audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. No technical issues? No, ma'am,
not at all.
Okay. So coming to my part, so this is my own theorization, which I have postulated. So this is about the culture, the fifth C of hardiness. So what happened was when I was working on this concept and I was trying to explore more about stress and hardiness, I also learned about the four C's of hardiness. But then I thought it's been a long time when Kobasa explored this concept of hardiness, and we had the other C as connection by S.R. Mahdi. And there has been a lot of changes in the world, especially in the corporate world. So there should be something underlying, or there should be something else which can also be a possible, like possible component of hardiness in the current times. So what could that be? So I tried to explore a lot of things, a lot of research articles, journals and everything. Then ultimately I thought, why not see about culture? Why not think about culture, our Indian culture? Because our Indian culture is very strong and very varied, and so very unique in nature. And the culture that I have in myself, and that has developed in me since my childhood, I have inculcated that since I was born, and I have tried to showcase it wherever I have gone. So that culture is imbibed in us since our childhood, and that culture is something which makes your whole personality. Like whatever you are right now at this stage of your life, it is the culture that reflects on you. So I thought, why not take culture as the fifth aspect of hardiness and try to explore it even more? But then what all aspects I should include? Because India is known to be a very varied and unique culture, and we have so many aspects attached to it. So we had limited time, and it was not also possible to explore all the aspects of Indian culture. So I took only 7 aspects, which I thought was related to corporate professionals. So the first one that I included in my scale, cultural scale, was collectivism. So what is collectivism? I will tell you after some time. So when we go ahead with the other slides. Second is Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga is something that is more related to Indian culture and Indian spirituality and philosophy. Third is family culture. So what is the family culture of India and how it defines a personality as hardy? That is what I wanted to say here. Then fourth is faith in God, which I think most of us have in different forms. But faith in God is something which is which I find more often in Indians. And a perpetual experience, that is your experience for life. And then self-knowledge. And last one is your social responsibility. So I thought like this 7 aspects taken together can be called as the overall Indian culture, or can be taken as the culture, another component of hardiness. And I developed a scale related to this, and I developed few questions. I circulated it to all the corporate professionals who were my sample. And then I got some data, and I was very happy to see that all the 7 aspects were confirmed. And I could see that these aspects are working on individuals and making them hardy personalities also. So coming to the deeper meaning of each one of them. What is collectivism? Collectivism is something which talks about being more collective in nature, collective mindedness, a we identity, a we feeling that we have in groups and communities. So collectivism is something that individuals identify themselves with a group. So we always feel like we belong to a group, and we are a part of a group. We are not separate individuals, but we belong to a group, and we have a group identity with that. So we feel that we are a part of a community, we are a part of a society, and we are not separate individuals. So whatever goals we will have our group goals. And whatever we do, we will do it for the group overall because of that we identity factor. So these collectivist or the collectivist culture, the people in this collectivist culture, they believe that the desire and goals of their group are more important than anyone else's individual ideas and interests. So when you work towards the group to group goal, or when you work for the group as a whole, you do not think about your own individual interest or self-interest. You always try to do something for the group as a whole. I think someone is raising a hand. Is he going to ask something?
Priyanshu, you can leave your question in the chat box and we can take it towards the end.
So is it good to go? Shall I continue?
Yes, ma'am, please.
Okay. So in a collectivist culture, individuals identify themselves with like belonging to a group, and whatever goals we have, that is all based on group goals. And you do everything for the group, everything for them, and as a whole, as a team. So you do not have this attitude of self-interest or individual interest. So how do we find this in corporate professionals? Now it is used, you will see that corporate culture has a lot of team-based system rather than individual-based system. Even the incentives are given team-based incentives rather than individual incentives, because we know that when the synergy of the team comes together, the performance or the product, like the output, is much more than the individual efforts. So this is what happens when you are working as a group, when you're working towards the common group goal. So this helps the organization also to have more, like to make the organization more productive and performance oriented when you have team-based individuals or team-based professionals in an organization. But there is a difference between individualism and collectivism. Now, not all culture or all countries have this collectivism. India is known to have a collectivistic culture, but there are many other countries who have an individualistic culture. Now, what is the basic difference that we, as a family member, tell our children, like since they are born or since they have some maturity to understand about things in life, we always tell them and we preach them to do what is best for the family, not what is, like, not like think for yourself and do it for yourself. So we always try to tell them, do it for your family. And if it is for a community, we say, do it for the community. If it is for the society, we say, do it for the society. So we try to help them out, or we try to preach this teachings to our children since they are at a very tender age, that we do it for the family because we are a unit. We are one unit, and whatever we do, we will do it for our family. And we will not look after our own selfish interest or individual interest. Now, there are a few countries who are more individualistic in nature. And Hofstede, who is like pioneer in the study in collectivism and individualism, he finds out, or he says that your collectivistic cultures include, but they are not limited to, most Latin American, Southern European, Middle Eastern, and Asian, African countries, tribal communities around the world. Now, individualistic cultures, they are those like people coming from Western societies, like English, German-speaking countries, Scandinavian countries, other Central and Northern European countries. So these countries are more individualistic in nature, or they have a culture which is more individualistic, which says, like, think about yourself, do it for yourself, rather than for the family or for the society or for the community. So our Indian culture has this more often, the collectivism, not individualism. Now, coming to this interesting aspect of Karma Yoga. So this is the second aspect of our Indian culture. Now, Karma Yoga is a Sanskrit term. Karma means work. And this is a term which is mentioned in our Vedas, like Bhagavad Gita. It is our Indian scripture, and it is a part of Mahabharata. The war between the Pandavas and Kauravas. The Indians here will know about it. Even the people who follow Bhagavad Gita and who are non-Indians here will also know that Bhagavad Gita is a very famous Hindu scripture, and it teaches a lot of life preachings. It is about the conversation of Arjuna and Lord Krishna. Krishna, who is the incarnation of Lord Vishnu. So this started off, or this conversation started off during the time of Dharma Yuddha, when they had the Pandavas had to fight with the Kauravas. And Arjuna was in a dilemma, moral dilemma, because he was fighting with his own family, his own beloved persons, his cousins, his relatives. So he said, I'm going to kill them. I'm going to fight with them. So I will sacrifice myself because of our collectivistic attitude or collectivistic culture. So he had this tendency and he said, like, he questioned Lord Krishna, is it the right thing that I'm doing? I'm going to fight with my beloved ones. And this is something which is not morally correct. Then Lord Krishna told him that this is something which is your duty and you have to do it. So this is your karma. This is your duty. You have to do it without even thinking of the result. So the Bhagavad Gita says this phrase, which is karmanya vadhyakaraste ma phaleshu kadachana, which translates, or the translation of English says that karma yoga begins with service without any expectation of the result. So you try to do your duty. You try to accomplish your duty. Do not have any expectation of the result. Do not think about what you're going to get out of your duty or what you're going to get out of the task that you have done in hand. So always do your duty with utmost sincerity, but do not expect the fruits or results of the duty that you have done. Now is the time that you have to perform your duty. And this is what karma says. You have to do your duty. You have to fight with them. But you should not be expecting the results. If you win or lose, that is also not your concern. But the time says, the current time says that you have to do your duty and you will have to do it very sincerely. So this was a dilemma which Arjuna had, and he had asked Lord Krishna. And this conversation has been explained very well in 700 verses in Bhagavad Gita. And one of those is this one, Karma Yoga. So Krishna also said, the work itself is the reward and the satisfaction of the job well done is the end by itself. So he says that the work you do, that is itself your reward. And when you try to accomplish this work in a fruitful manner, that is the satisfaction you get out of it. And that is the end in itself. It is not the process, but the end in itself when you try to accomplish your work or your duty at hand. Coming to the another quotation of Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan. Now he was the former vice president and also the president of Independent India. And he is well known for his philosophical ideas and his book that is Hindu Way of Life. And he was a very renowned philosopher. So he says, or he talks about Nishkama Karma Yoga, something very similar to Karma Yoga in Bhagavad Gita. He says that we have to perform our actions without expecting any fruit or reward. We have to perform it because it is our duty at hand. And we should not expect the fruits or results or outcomes of our performance. We have to perform, we have to do our duty, and we have to do it sincerely. This is something that, this proverb or this phrase has been famously used by many other researchers at many other places where they talk about culture or write about culture. Now, talking about the third aspect, which I considered in my scale, that was the family culture. So you all must be aware of this collectivistic culture as well as the joint family culture we have in Indian families. So India is known to have a joint family culture wherein you will find at least 3 to 4 generations living under one roof, having one common kitchen and having the same cultural values inculcated in them. So even if the contemporary world is like forcing you to stay apart or stay in different cities in India, still there is a strong bonding or attachment that you will find in Indians because of this joint family system or joint family culture that we have. So this is something that keeps us united. And when you are in a joint family, you learn a lot of sharing and caring. Now, how does this help in a working professional, you might ask me. So when you are in a joint family, you become very adjustive to the situations. You become very adaptable. You also try to understand or see people from their point of view. You try to put yourself in their shoes and you try to be more empathetic in your nature. So these things that you experience in your family, that also shows up in your workplace. So as and when you try to adapt yourself more often, as and when you try to accept or respect other people's opinion, you also become a better professional at workplace. So joint family system is something which is mostly seen in Indian culture and which people coming from joint family will have a different personality than people coming from nuclear families. And that also reflects on their professionalism or this professional life. So I feel that family culture is one such aspect which can make a hardy personality also. So the tradition of living in a joint family and being a part of even the extended family plays a significant role in formation of our culture, where we learn a lot of sharing and caring. And as I said, like the contemporary life requires living apart because the days are changing, the times are changing due to globalization, privatization. We have to like move on. We have to live in different cities, and the joint family system still it ceases to exist in the current times. But still we have that emotional bonding and attachment. And whenever we have some festivals or ceremonies, we come together and try to celebrate it together. And we always try to live together during those festive times. Coming to the next aspect, that is faith in God. As I said, like faith in God or the religion, India has a varied culture with many religions. And this religion is something which is not about just celebrating your festives or ceremonies, but it is something that you have experienced. You have experienced God in different forms, or you have experienced God guiding you towards the right path, or you have experienced God in some or the other form in some other individual. And I have also personally experienced, when I have a strong faith in God, I believe that whatever is going to happen, it is for my good. Because whatever plans I make, that are my own plans. But God has a different plan, and that is much above other plans. And that is the best. So I have a strong faith in God, and I feel that this is my belief. And my belief will take me further or take me ahead in time, and God will be there to help me out whenever there is a problem. And if at all I face a problem, there is that is something for my own good. That is something that will help me improve myself or perform better in future, or somewhere I'll be at a good place, a happy, I'll be a very happy and satisfied person in the long run. So whatever happens, happens for the good, is something which I have a strong faith in and believe in, because I have a strong faith in God. Now, many Indians also have this faith in God. So we feel that this is our biggest strength. No doubt that we have a strength of our own potentialities and caliber. But still then, the faith in God gives you a unknown strength, or some hidden strength comes, it surfaces, and you try to achieve more and more in life. So this is something which I find in Indian corporate professionals, and that was also proved in my study. So in Indian culture, God is not something that is away from this mundane world. It is something which has a living presence. We feel that God is with us, and God is guiding us at every step. And it is something that we try to accept, and we experience it in our lives. There are many situations where we are in a fix. We are in a situation where we do not find any solution. But in due course of time, I see that it is happening. It is taking, it is unfolding, and I'm able to see what is actually going to happen, and something good is going to happen, obviously. So it is something that you have to experience, and then you will get to know, or that faith in God will be stronger and stronger. And you will also become a stronger person in future. Coming to another aspect, the fifth one, which is perpetual experience. Now, perpetual experience is experiencing something forever, or something which clings on to you or stays on with you forever or for a long period of time. So this is something that is imbibed and encouraged in Indian culture, and we call it a swadhyaya, or we call it a self-study. So when we do self-study, or we try to study more about the aspects of culture, or the aspects anything and everything you want to learn, you should have that learning ability. Try to learn more, try to know more about the worldly affairs or the life teachings. So when you try to learn more, you get into self-study, or you get into swadhyaya, and you try to attain jnana. Jnana means knowledge and wisdom. So this perpetual experience is also seen in Indian culture, or Indians more often, because we have a habit of reading books. We have a habit of reading a lot of Hindu scriptures. We have a habit of going through a lot of religious books, not even only in Hinduism, but any other religion also. We depend a lot on those books and religious books. And we try to have the life preachings and lessons from different other books, which showcases some life situations, real life situations, and we try to learn from it. So we have this perpetual experience more often seen in Indians when they have a habit of reading or listening to noble thoughts, not only improves their wisdom, but they also have a worldly view about many aspects. And that gradually builds up your character and personality as a whole. So this is also something which is like imbibed in Indian culture. Now coming to self-knowledge, so this is about getting a knowledge about yourself. Now, many of us do not do this because we feel that we are perfect enough and we do not need to know what is what kind of a person I am. So you have to know who you are. And how do you get to know who you are? When you try to introspect your own actions, when you try to reason out what has happened, with whom, and whether it was right or wrong, whether it was morally correct or not. And you try to think or ponder upon your situations, your past, your present, your future, whatever. And you take some time to think over it. And you try to have knowledge about your own self. And why this is so important? Because when you are trying to know more about yourself, you're gaining knowledge about your own self, which will help you to improve you or groom you further and make you a better person in future. So self-knowledge is very important and this is vital. This is also called as Atma Jnana in Hindu way of life. So it is also called as Atma Jnana. Atma means your soul and Jnana means knowledge. So you have a self-knowledge or soulful knowledge about yourself, because that will help you be a better person, that will help you improve upon yourself day by day. So all other forms of knowledge are of secondary importance, but Atma Jnana is something which is vital and crucial, because if you know yourself better, you will be able to know others also better. And you will also get to know the reactions or repercussions of your own actions, your reasoning, your thoughts on others. And you will get to know what is the negative impact or the negativity that is spreading around you if you're not trying to know how how you are going to impact someone very negatively. So you have to be very well aware about yourself and you have to be very knowledgeable about who you are, or try to understand who you are so that you can be a better person and you can also help others out at times of need. The last one is social responsibility. So this is about the responsibility we have towards the society or the people living in the society. Now, how does this involve, how does this come into Indian culture, or how do we see, in which form? So when I was working in, when I was into my corporate life, at that time, I was working one day and I saw someone, we heard of someone having a cardiac arrest. And immediately I saw one of my colleagues standing up and going for his help. He called up an ambulance also and we admitted him on time. And then the person also survived. So this is the social responsibility. We had a very crucial project going on and we were working on it day and night. But at that moment, that was a priority and that was the responsibility we had to do. So my friend first, my colleague first, heard about this news, and then we all of us in our team, we supported him, we called up the ambulance, we helped him out, and we were very happy that he survived. So this is what is social responsibility in Indian culture. We keep the work aside, what we are doing, and we try to prioritize things, and we try to see what is more important at that particular time. And the most important time is now, and the most important person is who is there at that particular moment and who is in need of you. So you have to identify that, and you have to be responsible enough in supporting or helping out that person. And I see it more often in my friends and colleagues, and I've already experienced it also. So Indian culture teaches an individual to sympathize and empathize with other individuals in the society, and they have a responsibility for everyone else in the world also. So it is not like it is only restricted to the family members, or it is only restricted to your professionals or your friend, but it can be anyone, any individual. If we see that he or she needs help, it is our responsibility as a social being to help him or her out. Now, Swami Vivekananda, a very a famous Indian philosopher, he believes that God is present in everybody's heart. Now, when I started off this session, I said that each one of us has a divine soul, and I bow down upon you and I said namaste. So I feel that each one of us has God within us. And if we serve mankind, if we serve humans, we serve mankind or we serve humankind. And that is a very noble cause. Like we do a very noble cause out there. So he believed that God is present in everyone's heart, and service to mankind is service to God. So if you do, if you help out people, if you try to do service or duty for people in need, then you are doing a great deed and you are trying to serve your God. Now, how hardiness can be inculcated in HR Agile, or how hardiness can help organizations, or inculcating hardiness or training individuals in hardiness with the 5 C's of hardiness, how it will help organizations become more agile in HR, or how it will help in the more like help in the structuring and functioning of HR. Now, all the organizations usually have a very diversified workforce, and this workforce come from like this human resources, they come from different culture, different countries, and even if it is the same country, we come from different culture. So we have a very diversified workforce, and there is obviously a resistance to agility or resistance to change in the structure and functioning of the organization. So if we try to inculcate or train people with hardiness and with this 5 C's of hardiness, then maybe I feel that it will help organizations become more agile and have a sustainable and more productive organizational culture in future. So that's all for today. I'm done with my session, and thank you all for being so patient listeners. I'm open to questions if we have any here.
Thank you so much, ma'am. This was indeed such a wonderful learning and an insightful session, I must say. We will go ahead and take the questions now. So everyone, please feel free to drop your questions in the chat box, or you can raise your hand and then unmute yourself. Okay, so I can see the first question by Dr. Devabrata Sharma. He says that, ma'am, you said that people generally choose the option which is easy. So there should be people who deliberately choose the hard way, maybe to learn something or maybe to challenge themselves. What are your views on this?
Yeah, I have, like, life itself will give you a lot of challenges, Devabrata. So life is very harsh most of the times, and I have also myself experienced it. So I feel that if you live in the comfort zone, you will not be able to grow up. You will not be able to explore your hidden potentialities. You can explore yourself only when you are on the verge of a very challenging situation. And at the time when you try to overcome this challenge, you, in that process, you try to develop your own potentiality and caliber. And you try to explore the unexplored in yourself. And this has actually happened with me, and I have explored a lot of my hidden potentialities when I have faced a lot of challenging situation in my life myself. Yes, was that like, yes, Devabrata?
I don't think he's anymore here.
Okay,
he's here, I can see.
So does that justify your question?
Okay,
yes.
Okay, he says yes. Yes, Kashyap, please go ahead.
So first of all, before I ask my question, I really want to thank you, ma'am. This was indeed a very good session. Yeah, there would be a time when we'll thank you for the session, but trust me, it was very engaging. So thanks
thank
a lot
so
for
much.
That.
Thank you.
And my question to you is, ma'am, you explained us various components, the various C's of hardiness. But if we really want... Shalini, you can mute them yourself. Thank you. Yeah. So yes, ma'am, if we really want to summarize hardiness in 2 to 3 lines, so how will we do it apart from the components?
Okay. So hardiness is something that is, I would say it is not something that is in you when you are born, while you are born. So we see personality as a product of three things, like your family, your culture, and your environment or your situation. So culture has influenced the personality or a personality of an individual that we all know. But hardiness is something, a kind of personality which you will try to identify or which we will surface in you. You might be also having this hardiness, but you will be not aware of it unless you get into a situation like a very challenging one and a very tough one. Okay, so hardiness will be identifiable by any person only when he or she is into a very high stressful situation and he or she is unable to, like, feels like he is unable to cope with it. But if you are a hardy personality, if you are very committed to your work, if you're very sincere, dedicated, hardworking, and if you're a person who has a control over the events, who feels that I can control over the events, I can manipulate the things that are happening around me, and you are a person who has a very rich culture since your birth, then I feel that this hardiness will resurface and you will also one day become a hardy personality. So this is a different kind of personality. If you say, if I have to sum up in 2 to 3 lines, then it is a kind of personality which is different from those persons who are very stress prone and prone to illnesses. A hardy personality will be one who will be very strong enough and not that stress prone, but a stress resilient person, and will have less of illnesses in his life and less of issues also in his life.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I have just one more question. I am someone who gets stressed very easily. So how to convert that distress into eustress?
Okay. So you have to see the positive things out of the situation. Okay. So it is not like all of us are born perfect or all of us are leading a very happy and unstressful life. So stress will come in your life more often. Okay. But whenever you are into a very stressful situation, try to just identify the positive effects or positive aspects of that situation. Now, take for example, suppose I have a lot of work stress at my place and I feel like I'm on the verge of just breaking down or my mind is getting blown up and I'm not able to do my work. No. So at that time, how should I convert that stress into positive stress? I will try to develop some strategies and try to cope with the stress of work stress. How do I develop the strategies? You have to work on yourself. Okay, it is not like someone else is going to do it for you. You have to work on yourself. You have to do a time management. You have to schedule your work, all the work that you have, daily activities, and then you have to prioritize your work. Okay, when you try to prioritize your work and you try to segregate them into important and urgent, your work stress will be lessened. Okay, the things that are important might not be urgent, but the things that are urgent, that are very important to be done right away. So you have to categorize your work into 2 parts, important and urgent, and do the urgent work first and then get on to the important task later. So with that, you will get to understand, or you will only have a control over the things that are happening with you, because now you are only having a schedule of your own. You are able to divide the task into 2 parts and you know which are urgent and which are important, which are the things that have to be attended as soon as possible. Okay, so at that time you will reduce your work stress, and that time you will convert that distress. You will not allow that distress to come in you. You will still have that positive stress, because as in when you are trying to accomplish the urgent work and then the important work, you are having this positive stress because you are having a positive attitude towards the work and positive attitude towards that particular situation. So you will not allow the distress to come into you. Okay, so it is you who has to work on it. It is you who has to convert your distressful situation to eustress and not get into a distress situation at all. Even if the life situation tells you that you are going to have a distressful situation, you have to have a check on it and you have to work on it. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Do you think I have a question?
Next, I think Divyasha has raised her hand. Please go ahead.
Divyasha.
Hi, everyone. Good evening, ma'am.
Hi, good evening, Divyasha.
Good evening, ma'am. So first of all, I would like to say that was probably the most unique seminar or webinar I have ever attended, because it was a very sort of fresh topic and a fresh perspective on how on an HR topic, like hardiness in HR personalities. So that was a very, you know, a very fresh and unique topic. And it, and the way you presented it was really informative and engaging. So thank you so much for it. I probably learned a lot of new things today. So my question today for you will be, so, you know, you said that hardiness is a, like, is developed in individuals who are exposed to high stress situations very early on in life, and they are used to cope with such situations.
Mm-hmm.
So let's take an individual X. So he or she has faced a lot of high stress situations from very early on in life, from their childhood.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, for this individual, he develops, he does have a hardy personality, but you know, he has sort of trauma that he has carried on from his past, from, you know, as a byproduct of such high stress situations. So the hardiness personality that you said, is it really worth it? Because you know, as an adult, if that person X thinks that I didn't need to be strong, I wanted to be a child that time, so you know, I hope whatever I'm saying makes sense, because yeah, so that person, so I wanted to ask if the hardiness personality or the hardiness trait in a person is really worth it if he or she carries mental trauma from their past, you know, stressful situations.
Okay, so I can give you an example here, Divyasha. So like from my personal experience, like how Shalini said that I have lived through hardiness. So that is true. And I can also certify myself as a hardy personality, because I have come across a lot of difficult situations in my life. And there have been situations where I feel like I'm going to break down, but then I again pull up myself and I stand up. So how does that happen? Because I have already inculcated that hardy personality in me. Okay. So recently I lost my father, and it was a like shock and trauma for me, a very painful thing that happened with me. I lost my loved one. And just when I lost him, after 3 to 4 days, I had to submit the first proof of my book. And I also had to do the indexing part of my book, the book that Shalini gave an introduction about in the beginning. So this book, which you see, like which you have heard of throughout this webinar, and the one like this webinar is also related to whatever I've written in my book in a very a smaller version of whatever I've written. So at that time, I was into a very bad state of mind, and I was in trauma, obviously. And I was, I thought like I will not be able to meet my target. And I was such a person, I was a very committed person, as I say. So if I say I'm a hardy personality, I would say that I'm a very committed individual. I have a control over my events. So I thought, okay, this is a situation which is not in my control. And losing my father was also not in my control. But what is in my hand is I have to meet this target, because I am a committed person, and I will take it up as a challenge, and I will try to overcome it, and I will try to finish all my work and submit my work within the deadline itself. And June 4th was the deadline. May 28th, I lost my father. It took me 2 days of time make myself a better person, or make as like the broken pieces were again coming together, and then
to recompose.
I walked day and night, and I did my indexing of my book. I did the first proof reading also. At that time, you can imagine what would be my mental state. But during that situation also, I didn't lose my hardiness. That was a very high emotional stressful situation for me. But I did my work, I accomplished my task, because I was committed to it. I said, I will control this event, I will control this situation anyhow. And I have to do it, because I'm committed to a person, I'm committed to an organization, and I have to do it anyhow. So I worked day and night, and I submitted it within the deadline. And fortunately, there were no errors in it. And you see the book getting published today. So if you have that hardy personality inculcated in you, or you have identified it somewhere, in any phase of your life, that will not leave you at all. because you already have these ingredients in you, all the components of hardiness in you. So that will only drive you towards better performance. That will only drive you to overcome all the challenges that you face in life. And that will not leave you at all. That will be with you. That will become a part of you. And you cannot just leave it, or you cannot just forego it. So Divyasha, if you have that hardy personality, then it is worth it. I would say it is worth it, and it will be worth it in the long run also.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a really satisfactory answer, and it was a really good answer. I really understood what it really means to have a hardy personality, and yeah, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Okay, so the next question we have is from Ashveer in the chat box. He says, what motivated you to write this book, ma'am?
Okay, my own situations, I would say. So when I was I'm a postgraduate in clinical psychology, clinical and counseling psychology. And as a part of my course curriculum, we were counseling patients, real patients. Even suicidal patients and also depressive patients, patients who are undergoing neurotic issues or neurotic disorder. So when I was working with them, I was very upset. I was not I felt like, why people are undergoing this situation? There should be something that should not let them be at the stage where they are right now. There should be something that should stop them. That should make them more positive towards life, more positive towards life situations. So after my post-graduation, I did my MBA, and then I worked with Accenture. In Accenture also, while I was working, there was a lot of workload, work stress, and we were working as a team. In that team also, I found a lot of work stress, like in all the corporate professionals, be it in my team or other teams. So I again found stress as a factor which is trying to deteriorate your performance or being detrimental to your functioning, your mental well-being or your physical functioning. So that was again a huge concern, and that triggered me again to work on this topic, stress. But my question was still unanswered. Something that should help you out in managing your stress or overcoming it and converting this stress into you stress and more positive stress, so that you perform better, you get yourself motivated, and you try to achieve whatever you want to achieve in life. So when I thought of doing PhD in this topic, when I thought of getting into teaching and do PhD, the only topic that came into mind was this one, stress, and how to manage stress, how to overcome stress and not get into a situation where you will be ruining your life, or you feel like you're going to end your life and there is no hope at all. So I wanted to see there should be a ray of hope or some light at the end of the tunnel. Now, what are the things that can help you overcome the stress? So I started reading a lot on this topic. I started to read a lot of articles, journals, and everything related to stress management. And I was more concerned about relating stress management with one's personality, because an individual is unique in itself or in himself or herself because of the personality. You will not find personalities alike in twins also. Even identical twin or fraternal twins, they will also have different personalities because each person is unique from the other. So I found personality as something very intriguing, or some factor that I can relate to stress management. So I thought of relating stress with personality. Then my focus was more on reading on stress and personality. And I came across stress and hardiness, because hardiness is a personality disposition and a personality type or trait, you can say. So I came across this concept. And then when I came across the 3 C's and then the 4th C, I thought, why not include culture and make it another component of hardiness? Because India is known for its varied culture and unique culture. And because of my culture, my family culture, my Indian culture, this is where I stand today. So that backs me up, or that supports me a lot of times. And that brings in a lot of strength in me. So then I thought of working on this as a research work in my thesis. And after getting a PhD, I was working on it to publish as a book. And fortunately, it got accepted by Routledge, New York, UK, Taylor & Francis, and it got published on July 12th. So this is how like the interest in this topic came up. Hope that justifies your question.
Thank you, ma'am. It was great listening to your story behind this book. Even I didn't know this. Okay, so the next question is from Shubham. He says it was really a nice and wonderful session regarding the 5 C's. He got to know many aspects of life with real life examples. So his question is how one should handle these setbacks. And in corporates, we have to go through many odds, irrespective of our hard work and dedication towards work. And sometimes the work culture doesn't suit. So how can one get out of it in a positive note?
Okay. So setbacks are very common, Shubham. Setbacks in your professional life or personal life, you will have setbacks of your own. And again, those setbacks will be very unique to your life situations. But take it very positively, because when you have a setback, don't take it as a setback. Okay, don't think that this is something that is stopping me to go further. So learn from those experiences, learn how that affected you, or learn why this happened. Okay, and try to take this as a positive experience of life, try to take it as a learning, and try to move ahead in life, because setbacks are a part of life, or failures or rejections are a part of life. And again, when you said that the work culture doesn't suit you, so above that work culture, you have your own culture. Okay, you have own your own family culture, you have own your own culture that is imbibed in you since your childhood. So that should be the strength for you. So work culture will not match to your culture, or work culture will not be as you want it to be. But it is up to you how you can turn that adversity into a satisfying situation, and not recognize it as a setback, but as a learning experience, and try to improvise yourself. Yeah, Shubham? Keep yourself dedicated. Yes. And keep working hard. That will give you good results. Okay, not like do your hard work, do whatever your duty says you to do. Don't expect for the results, because when you keep on doing the good work with utmost sincerity and hard work, it ultimately pays off, and you will see yourself as a better personality in future, a better hardy personality in future.
Yes, ma'am. I hope this answers Shubham's questions well. Okay, so before I move on to the next.
Okay, maybe Shalini has some connectivity issues.
Yeah, I think she's back.
Yes. Yes, so I'm just saying that before I move on to the next question, I would like to inform everyone to fill the form that is given in the chat box. It is a feedback cum attendance form, so please make sure to fill it in order to get your participation certificate. Okay, so the next question is from Sebego. I think he has 2 questions. I'll read out the first one. How can one change from being a complainer to someone who is committed, as you know, procrastination experience?
Okay, so here's the question, I think. How can one change from being a complainer to someone who is committed? Okay, as you know, procrastination experience. Okay. So first of all, procrastination is not going to work well for you in the long run. So you have to do the time, do the task on time whenever it is required to do so. And how can you convert this being a complainer to someone being committed? When you realize the worth of the work, when you realize the worth of your relationship, when you realize the things that you do has a purpose or a meaning into it, okay? So, and that meaning will be something that is good for you, good for your family, good for your professional life, good for your personal life. You need to identify that meaning, and you need to you need to see that purpose, the hidden purpose in your life or hidden purpose that will help you grow as a better person. So if you're a complainant or if you're trying to complain all the time about life situations, you are not going to be a better person, obviously. You will not grow in life, okay? And unless you try to be more committed towards the relationships or family or the life situations, then only you will be a committed person. But again, when can you be a committed person? When you know what is your duty, what is your responsibility, and what is the task at hand, which only you can do and no one else. When you have that realization in yourself, you will be self-motivated. You will have a self-drive towards accomplishing the task and become more committed and not a complainant anymore. Hope this justifies, Tebogo.
Okay, so moving on to the last question. It is by Subhalakshmi Sahu. She says that, ma'am, you said that connection is one important part of the 5C, but sometimes it also becomes a barrier in life, like some people misuse your connection or stop you from doing the right thing. And we can't break our connection with those people. So what to do in those situations?
Okay. So connection here, I'm talking about the connect or the bonding you have with someone whom you can confide in. Okay. So choose the person with whom you can confide. That is the foremost thing that you need to identify first. Always try to choose a person who will be non-judgmental and who will understand you at all situations. Now, certain things, as you said, like you want to do something, but this connection does not allow you to do that. I understand what you're saying here, but I always feel that follow your dreams, follow your aspirations, because you get only one life and that life is very precious to you. And if you want to achieve something in life, which your connection is not allowing you to do so, or that bonding or attachment is restraining you to do so, then I would say sit and talk to them, convince them. I hope this is about your parents, Subhalakshmi. You want to achieve something in life and because of that connection, they're stopping you to do so, to achieve that in life. Is it right, Subhalakshmi? Are you there?
Would you like to unmute?
I think the hidden meaning was that. So she said that it acts as a barrier in life, like some people misuse your connection or stop you from doing the right thing. And we can't break our connection with, no, don't break your connection with those people. But if it is something that you really want to achieve in life, you really want to see yourself attaining that in life, then go for it. Okay. And the people who love you, understand you, will understand you always. And they will not, like that will not break your connection with them also. The true ones will always be with you.
I hope that answers your question well, Subhalakshmi. Okay, so there's one last question by Siddharth. He has sent the question to me personally. He says, anytime, like his question is how to handle myself and my family when the things are not in our hand, and how to motivate our family also at that time.
Okay, can you specify some situation or just give an example? Because I feel this is a very generalized question. Unless I know what he's asking, like anything specific, Siddharth?
Siddharth, would you like to please unmute yourself?
Yes, ma'am. It's all about the specific.
Okay. Like how to handle myself and my family when the things are not in our hand and how to get motivated. Okay. So there are certain things which will not be in your control. I do agree with it. When I was talking about control as another sea of hardiness, I do agree that all the situations or events will not be in your control. Like how I said, losing my father was not in my control. That was not something that I predicted also, but that happened. And that kind of impacted me deeply. So certain things are there which will not be in your control, but it is you who has to choose not to be reduced by that or not to be affected by that. So long as you try to lose yourself in that, okay, in that situation. So always try to be more like clinging on to who you are, and not try to change yourself or not try to do something which will reduce yourself or which will lessen your personality. So always try to achieve something or always try to be who you are, irrespective of the situation. It is you, Siddharth, who has to work on it. So whatever I said, it is up to you who has to, like the individual has to work on it. The individual has to train himself or herself regarding all these aspects. It is no one else who is going to do it. It is you who has to do it. So don't try to, don't allow that event to like lessen your personality to a great extent. Okay?
Ma'am, can I say something?
You stay strong. Huh?
Can I say something?
Yes, Siddharth.
Ma'am, in that time, I know that what the events is going on, and I know about how to handle that situation. But what about my family, that they don't know about this kind of a thing, and how to motivate them, that kind of a thing?
Okay, you have to keep on trying, Siddharth, because when you are a child, your parents or your family protect you, your family, your parents try to guide you. So now when you see that your family is not going on the right path, or they are not doing what is supposed to be done, then it is now your duty to convince them, or it is now your turn to be the parent for them. Okay, so try to convince them and try to make them realize that this thing will not be good for any one of you. So if you want to be happy and satisfied in life or have a good emotional health or mental health, then you need to overcome it, and you should be the guiding light here. Okay, Siddharth?
Yes, ma'am, got it. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, so now that we are done with the question and answer round, I would again like to thank you, ma'am, with my whole heart for your time and effort, and also everyone else for participating to this webinar. I would love to invite Lakshmi ma'am now, the co-founder and director at Pearls Religions, to give the valuable vote of thanks.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Pallavi. This was such a wonderful session. And whatever you shared, I mean, it resonated very well, I would say. So thank you so, so very much for your wonderful time, for your wonderful insightful intellect, I must say. And last but not the least, I should say thanks to Shalini for inviting you and, you know, helping all of us enlighten today. Thank you so very much.
Thank ma'am. You so much, ma'am. Thank you. It was a pleasure being here.
In fact, our pleasure and Culture Legion's pleasure, I would say. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
So on behalf of the Culture Legends team, we thank you all for joining us today and hope you all enjoy the rest of your day as well. We keep having these webinars once or twice every month. So if you find today's session useful, stay tuned as we have more such coming on. And please, if you have any questions, you can always ask them by using our channel and our social media.
Okay, I think she got disconnected.
I think there's some technical glitch. Okay, so at last, let's not forget our agenda, which is let's write the future through agile HR methodology. I now request all of you to please turn on your cameras so that we can take a virtual group picture together.